This is part two of square roots and radicals. In part one, we were looking at numbers and using the square root symbol right here, which gives us the principal square root and on negative numbers. The square root of 9 means what number times itself is 9, and that would be 3, etc. Now we're going to look at some variables. So let's say we were just squaring something. So I'm going to do x squared squared. So I'm squaring x squared. And if you know your laws of exponents, you just get to multiply the exponent, so that's x to the fourth. Or how about if I did x cubed and squared that using the law of exponents? You write the base and you can multiply the exponents 3 times 2 and get x to the sixth. And you could do this for any number. Let's say I was doing x to the eighth squared. Again, you write the base and multiply the exponents, get x to the 16th. Now, if you forget the laws of exponents, you can do this the long way, for instance, by writing x cubed squared as x cubed times x cubed, and you could use the law of exponents where you add the exponents, right? You write the base down once and add the exponents. But if you actually forgot that, you could actually write x cubed as x times x times x, and then the next x cubed as another x times x times x, and you're still going to get x to the sixth. So make sure that if you forget the laws of exponents, that you just go down all the way to the basics. All right, so here we go. I can see that I'm squared some things and got like x to the fourth, x to the sixth, and x to the 16th. So this column here, x to the fourth, x to the sixth, and x to the 16th, all of those are perfect squares. So the question is, what is the square root of each of these? And you would think, well, the square root of x to the fourth is x squared, right? Because I took x squared and squared it to get x to the fourth. And it's a little bit tricky, so it's true in this case that the answer is x squared. X to the sixth could be slightly trickier. You notice that it's x cubed squared that got x to the sixth, so this should be x cubed, but there's a problem here. If x was a negative number, all right? If x was a negative number, note what you just took the square root of something, this x cubed would also be a negative number. So in reality, it's the absolute value of x cubed. That's a way of making it positive. But to make things simple, we're just going to assume the variables are positive number. So since we're just learning about it, we'll assume the variables are positive. All right? So to be honest, this is really the absolute value of x cubed. That would be a way of making sure that x cubed was not negative, correct? Now, I don't really have to do that for the x squared because when I square something, it's already positive. And so for this last one, the square root of x to the 16th, by the way, a common mistake is for somebody to write x to the fourth, but that's not true because notice it was x to the eighth that I squared to get x to the 16th. So this has to be x to the eighth. And then keep in mind that that would be positive no matter what, right? Because something to the eighth power would be positive. Okay, so to make things simple, we'll assume the variables are positive. So if we assume that all variables are positive, then we don't need to put the absolute value around the x cubed right here. Okay, no absolute value sign is necessary if x is positive, correct? All right, now let's just analyze this a little bit more. Notice what happened when you square something. So if I do x squared squared, I get x to the fourth, and x cubed squared, I got x to the sixth, and x to the eighth squared, I got x to the 16th. So when I squared something, really using your laws of exponents, you took the original exponent and multiplied by 2, right? Because you multiply the two exponents here. So what happens when you square a variable to some exponent? You end up with an even exponent. So notice x to the fourth, x to the sixth, x to the 16th, they're all even exponents because, well, when you squared it, you ended up multiplying 2 times some number. So it's going to be even. So that leads us to this. A variable with an even exponent is a perfect square, right? Because you squared something and you got something with an even exponent. So x to the fourth, x to the sixth, x to the 16th, these are all perfect squares. That's why when I took the square root of them, we don't have a square root symbol anymore, right? So when I take the square root of x to the fourth, we get x squared. Taking the square root of x to the sixth, I get x cubed. Taking the square root of x to the 16th, I get x to the eighth. What happens when you take the square root of some variable to an even exponent? What's the answer going to be? I had square root of x to the 16th, I ended up with x to the 8th. What happens to the exponent? It's halved, right? You multiply by 2, right? The 8 times 2 when you're squaring it, and when you're taking the square root, you get exactly half the exponent going backwards. So let's see. What would it be if I said, what is the square root of m to the 10th? This is a variable with an even exponent, so to take the square root of it, I get the same variable but with half the exponent, m to the 5th. What would square root of m to the 18th be? Square root of m to the 18th, well, even exponent. So it's going to be a perfect square, right? Half the exponent, m to the 9th. So here's a couple more problems. How about if I had square root of m to the 8th? We're assuming all variables are positive. Square root of b to the 30th. Square root of n to the 16th. All right, what are these going to be? Well, they're perfect squares because the exponents are even. So when we're working with variables, if the exponent's even, it's going to be a perfect square, and I just take half the exponent. So you write the base down, and we could just do half the exponent. This is the tricky one, n to the 16th. Be careful. You still just take half the exponent. A common mistake is to take the square root of it just because you can, but that's not it. All right, let's try this. Simplify each of these. Now notice it's not just a square root of 16 or a square root of x to the 16th, but basically if they're products, you just take the square root of each factor in here. So the square root of 16 is 4, and the square root of x to the 16th is, what do? Take half the exponent, x to the 8th. All right, let's do the next one. This is a perfect square. Square root of 36 is 6. And then the square root of m to the 10th is, you write the m with half the exponent. And the last one, square root of 9 is 3. Square root of m to the 8th. All these variables have even exponents, so we're doing great. M to the 4th. Half the exponent for n to the 4th is n squared. And half the exponent here is just y to the first, which we write as y. Okay? So far we have dealt with taking square roots of what we're going to call perfect squares. For instance, like 16, 36, and 9 are all perfect squares because you take a whole number and square it and you get those numbers. But later we'll be doing some problems that are not perfect squares and figuring out how to solve, I'm sorry, simplifying that. So if we take the square root of, for instance, 10, this is going to be an irrational number because there isn't like a whole number that you square to get 10. So we're going to be dealing with how to approximate irrational numbers and how to simplify square roots that are not perfect squares underneath this radical sign, etc. So far we've dealt only with problems where we had perfect squares, 9, 36, 16, etc., or where we had variables with even exponents, also perfect squares. So we'll be dealing with this in later videos.